Thanks to everyone who is attending this particular presentation. I really appreciate it that you're here. For those of you who this is your first webinar today, please know that no one can see you, no one can hear you. So you don't have to like feel like you're you know, anyone's watching you. The only people who can be seen and heard are the people on the screen. Also, if you have any questions, just scroll down to the bottom or move your cursor down to the bottom where it says chat, and you type in, you click the chat button, and there you can put in your questions and how Professor Laney wants to answer that, whether during the lecture or more likely at the end of the presentation, he can do so. All right, with that being said, let me introduce very quickly our speaker. We have Professor Rob Laney, who is an instructor of music here at Weatherford College and also the chair of the Fine Arts Department. His presentation today is Shared Spaces in Jazz Music and Democratic Governance. And that is it.
Thank you, Scott. Well, again, I want to thank everybody for coming, and we're going to hit some challenging ideas, maybe some entertaining ideas that have to do with the overall scope of this year's conference, Freedom. And what better way to talk about freedom in music than through jazz music. So I'm going to share my screen and take us all through a PowerPoint presentation. Now, maybe you can see me in screen. Great. All right. Well, this first slide is a painting by Jasper Johns called Three Flags. There's a couple of things that we could point out about this. Usually a painting, when it has depth perception, it goes backwards. You got the foreground and then background, background, background like that. But Jasper Johns reverses it. Instead, these flags are coming at you. Now, a couple of different ways he presents these flags. One is they're stacked on top of one another in exact proportions. And also kind of a opposite aesthetic to that exactitude are the brush strokes are kind of messy, okay? So what is Jasper Johns trying to talk to us about here? Is it a balance of precision and regulation and balancing that with free form, with, you know, freedom? Well, that aspect of that kind of balance in this painting is also, I believe, an aspect in the freedom in jazz music and the freedom in democratic governance. So one of the basic premises here is going to be that there is a way to organize a musical ensemble that reflects a government structure. For example, of course, in a symphony, you have one person in charge, the person on the podium with the baton, telling everybody when to play, how to play, their interpretation. And if that were a parallel to a government structure, it'd be an authoritarian structure, total control. Okay, how about absent any of that control? The government structure might be anarchy, no structure, no rules. The kind of music that would represent would be a type of music concrete, which is if you were to go out into nature, to the street corner with your microphone and record whatever kind of sound happens, and then using that sound as a musical sound, where you're not manipulating the sound. You're using whatever happens, and that's your musical sound. So that's absent any kind of regulation. So those are our parameters. You've got total regulation and no regulation. Well, the premise of this specifically is that in democratic governance, you have a shared control, and that happens in music through jazz and through the organization of how the best jazz combos operate. Let us throw one another into the deep end, as it were. And let's start this way. Hang on, everything's gonna make sense in a second. This painting is Jackson Pollock. It was on the cover of an album of Free Jazz by Ornette Coleman. Now, you could say, you could look at all that chaos and listen to all that noise, and you might say to yourself, oh, anybody could do that. All right, we're gonna put a pin in that. That's a different discussion, okay? And that's a discussion for another time about, you know, couldn't a three-year-old do that? Well, all right, but Jackson Pollock did something to painting that Ornette Coleman did to music that was highly influential in going into the modern period. And so Ornette Coleman thought by putting this painting on the album cover. In recording this piece of music, he brought the highest level musicians into the studio and said, no rules, everybody, except for one, and that is listen to one another. So if you are taken off any kind of the regulation except for just listen to one another, you might get the following. Musicians are trained to kind of have an intuition about other musicians that they're playing with and listening to one another. They're kind of reading each other's minds, kind of like I was reading your mind and thinking, oh yeah, it sounds like a bunch of trash. Well, okay. Those musicians in that recording, you can imagine that they're all holding a note. Okay, that worked forever, what that was. Let's do it again. And without planning it in the moment, let's do it again. And then it crumbles into pieces and then forms its own sort of logic. This music is by a local. There are a handful of musicians from Fort Worth, Texas that have changed the course of music history. T-Bone Burnett is a famous music producer. Van Cliburn made Fort Worth a classical piano town. And when this young lion, Ornette Coleman, took jazz into a brand new direction, it really inspired a lot of people. It did turn off some people, but inspired a lot of people too, such as the Grateful Dead, because ensembles were like, you know what? If we listen, the music can be improvised collectively. And on that album cover, he coins the term collective improvisation. Okay. So what we're listening to here is one person soloing. But that's not the only way jazz can organize itself. Sometimes in jazz, you can have the improvisation happen as a group. Instead of people taking turns improvising, collective improvisation. Okay. Now, that's all well and good, but it's not just the lack of regulation. You have to do something more with it, such as the painter says, the works must be confused with fire in the soul, but executed with clinical coolness. There's a balance of freedom and regulation. About that lack of precision, Dave Brubeck says, jazz stands for freedom. It's supposed to be the voice of freedom. Get out there and improvise, take chances, and don't be a perfectionist. leave that to classical musicians. Okay, fine. Does that mean that jazz musicians are not perfectionists and they don't have any rules? We're going to get to that misconception a little bit later. They do, in fact, have rules. And this is the most basic rule book of popular music. When I teach the history of popular music, I say that the blues is number one. Everything grows out of the blues. All popular music, rhythm and blues, rock and roll, country music has its roots in the blues. And so any jazz player worth their salt can get together with another group of jazz players and say, okay, everybody, blues and B flat, ready, go. And those players have memorized the 12-bar blues and the order of harmonies that they come. So you see here, you've got the one harmony with that Roman numeral one based on the tonic of the key, okay? Then four steps up from that tonic, a new harmony, the four chord. Back to the one for four beats. The one again for four beats. The four chord harmony that we had before for four beats. Another measure of four. Back to the one. Another measure of the one. The five chord. The four chord. The one. Up to the five. And back to the beginning of the cycle. You can hear that happen in this example. One chord, four chord, one chord, one chord, the four, four again. Five, four, one, five. So Gary Clark Jr. here from Austin is gonna play a figure. Other guy's gonna pick up on it. So in the first cycle, the soloist was bonga, and then the other guitarist picked up on that same phrase, bong gong. They were trading back and forth. I'm listening to you, you did the figure, I'll do that figure back to you. So that's kind of a back and forth between two musicians. And you can hear another similar kind of listening between these two blues musicians. John Mayer is finishing a solo. And when B.B. King plays his solo on Lucille, I want you to hear the band. What's the band giving right now? And the band gives him something different at the top of the cycle. Kind of mellow. It's warming up. The band gives him more, and as a result, he does with more passion. It's that interplay of listening, okay? in that case, the band and soloist. All right. Now, here is a misconception about freedom, maybe. You ever walk into Central Market and see the wall of apples? You got two dozen different kinds of apples, and you're paralyzed. You don't know where to begin. The tyranny of too many choices, people have called it. So if you only had like three or four different kinds of apples, that'd be easier. Well, the way to think about that in a musical way, Stravinsky had something to say about that. My freedom will be so much the greater and more meaningful, the more narrowly I limit my field of action and the more I surround myself with obstacles. Whatever diminishes constraint, diminishes strength. The more constraints one imposes, the more one frees oneself of the chains that shackle the spirit. So maybe it's a misconception that the more freedom you have, the fewer rules that you have. Well, necessity is the mother of invention, and it helps to focus the creativity sometimes when you give yourself rules, when you have something to work against. So thought also John Coltrane. And he challenged himself to do something more difficult than the one chord, the four chord, and the five chord in the blues. That's very elementary, and he takes it to a very complex degree in his composition, Giant Steps. He wanted to give himself some harmonies that are very difficult to improvise around as an exercise to make himself become a better improviser. Well, someone wrote down all of the notes that that is played here. And it's mind-blowingly difficult. Okay, let's just stop right there. Right away, you've got like five different kinds of harmonies and the song is only a second and a half in. You see that first harmony over here, this G major seven? And this B flat seven, those two chords only have one common pitch to them. They're distantly related. That one, the four, and the five were on the same key and they share a lot of the same notes. He wanted to make it difficult on himself to find the correct improvisation notes to play. And they're just playing the top of the melody before the solos start. And when John Coltrane solos, it is like that person that you know that cannot stop talking. They have something to say and that reminds them of the next thing to say, and they just don't know how to stop talking. And they just like dominate the conversation because they just keep going and they keep going. And John Coltrane had a problem with that. He knew that he just was the stream of consciousness thing. He just kept going and kept going. He approached his friend Miles Davis. Miles, I got a problem. You got to help me with my problem. When I play, I just keep playing and I keep playing, and my musical thought engenders another musical thought, and I follow that wherever that's going to lead. It leads me to a new thing, and I just can't play it. And I've been playing hours and hours, and I don't know how to stop. Miles, you got to help me. How do I stop? And Miles says, take the horn out your mouth, which is very concise, which is what Miles Davis does. He had just the right note at the right time, but John Coltrane is about to fly. Solo. talk about drinking from a fire hose, right? That is upside down at 100 miles an hour, backwards calculus. The intellectual achievement of that is just mind-blowing. It is no accident that you have a fire inside the bell of John Coltrane's tenor saxophone. Thank you for showing us the possibilities of that kind of freedom within really complex regulation. Okay. Now, what about in a team? If you're playing in a team, this famous soccer coach from Barcelona says, I don't like it when a player says, I like freedom, I want to play by myself. Because the player has to understand he's part of a team with 10 other players. If everyone wants to be a jazz musician, it will be chaos. Okay. We'll not be a team and nothing will be possible. Fine. Okay. I forgive a Spaniard for not understanding jazz the way Americans do, and that's fine. Well, does that mean that jazz equals chaos? Well, he does have a point, of course. It's a spectrum of absent control to total control. And when you're playing on a team, when you're playing in a symphony, when you're playing in a jazz orchestra, you got to be listening to the band too, in the context of one of the greatest composers ever. I think that Duke Ellington is going to be counted along the same lines of genius as Stravinsky. His orchestration was on par with Stravinsky's. He would have the saxophones play low in their range, have the trombones play high in their range, and then put a muted trumpet right in the center to get a new kind of coloristic effect. And the voicings were, you know, broke new ground in jazz. So here is his jazz orchestra. And you're going to hear this back and forth first between sections, between saxophones and trumpets and trombones, back and forth. And when the soloist happens, he's listening to the band and they're not stepping on one another's toes, like in a conversation that you might have with somebody. Let them finish their thought, you add a thought. They wait for you to finish. There's a back and forth. Musically speaking, sounds like this in Take the A Train. The solo. They wait for each other. That's called call and response. You're going back and forth between a soloist and a group. They're taking turns. That's their agreement. That's their rules. That's their regulation. I'm going to say what I want to say, and you can say what you want to say, but we're not, this time, not going to step on one another's toes. This time, there's going to be a type of jazz where they are all stepping on one another's toes at the same time. That collective improvisation, where you're not taking turns. All right, so I've said a lot about group and listening, and Pep Guardia does have a point when he talks about the jazz musician wants to be all about themselves. There is something, of course, to be said about the role of the individual in improvisation, of course, such as, I love improvisation. You can't blame it on the writers. You can't blame it on the direction. You can't blame it on the camera guy. It's you. You're on. you've got to do it. And you either sink or swim with what you've got. Well, yes, of course. Yeah. I mean, you're the one coming up with what to say and what to play. It is about the individual. And let's put that in a jazz context of yet another royal appellation. Duke called himself the Duke, and Count Basie calls himself the Count. And in his big band stuff, we're going to hear these guys take turns in this example here. There's the Count. And it's his band, he gets to solo first. Now we're learning something about this individual. The notes that they play are their personality. So tell us about yourself, clarinet. What type of guy is he? He's a smart cat, right? All right, new guy. Chill it out. The drummer likes the relaxed phrase. So yeah, the individual does shine through there. And back to the topic of what I'm talking about, that the shared space of jazz music and democratic governance, there is this balance between the importance of the group and the importance of the individual. There was that quote from the comedian, and some comedians that are good at improvising, they know that what it takes to be a good improviser. They have this exercise that they do sometimes when they get together and they're all going to improvise. It's a yes and. It's never a no. That if someone has a new idea, you don't say no to it. You go with it. And Malcolm Gladwell has something to say about that bad improvisers block action, often with a high degree of skill. Good improvisers develop it. All right. So how do you be a good improviser to develop the interplay between musicians, and you balance that group mentality with each individual voice? And we can do that with Satchmo. Louis Armstrong, he was the ambassador of jazz around the world for a long time. He's got that gravelly voice. Well, in Dixieland music, the way that it's structured is everybody solos at the same time. It is collective improvisation. You don't take turns. So here's an example of that style.
Now we can even get more musical than that. Remember, collective improvisation is about creating an arrangement on the spot. So one of the ways we do that is by paying more attention to the phrasing. So Vince and I on this next chorus are going to leave a little more space and be thoughtful about where we're placing these ideas and where we're putting the voice leading. And in the chorus after that, we're all going to step it up a little bit by using some of the expressive language of our instruments and get some real feeling.
They're going to be listening to one another. They'll let each other play.
Here's some feeling now.
Thank you.
So you might find yourself hanging out in New Orleans and you hear the Dixieland and they're doing this collective improvisation thing. And you may wonder, if you're new to the country, how do Americans see themselves in the context of their country? Well, we all allow one another to be ourselves. The American dream tells us you're free to follow your dream. You're free to have your own voice. You're free to have your own opinion, speak your mind in a democratic society. And everyone does, a lot of times at the same time. But we're also all following the rules and we're all listening to one another. We're free to be ourselves and we're doing it in a group. And there's a balance of these ideas of individual and group. And, you know, they're not planning this. They didn't plan this. They're determining what they're going to say based on what the other person is doing.
Get from this gallows.
What you have been choking about
ain't going nowhere.
You ain't going nowhere.
Yeah. Just sitting there grabbing.
Grabbing
at the blood round my rocking chair.
Rocking chair.
I remember dear old Aunt Harriet.
I remember old Aunt Harriet.
How long in heaven she be?
Oh, about a year and a half, Daddy.
What they're doing is not dictated by the other person, but maybe suggested by the other person. It's the interplay. And that's what makes like a good jazz ensemble. You get next time you hear a jazz ensemble, such as April the 30th, All About the Music concert here at the Alkek Theater, you're gonna hear these jazz musicians listen to one another. If you sit down and hear whether or not you know you're hearing good jazz or not, it's not just, okay, there's a soloist. Wow, is he impressive? You know that the jazz musicians are doing it right. If one person's idea is then picked up by the other person's idea and it develops on the spot as a group, these individuals doing themselves as individuals and in a group. Yeah. And it could be argued that that's what good American governance does. The relationship of the individual to the group together in a balance. But then I think Ayn Rand would disagree with me. She thinks freedom is to ask nothing, expect nothing, depend on nothing. Is that freedom? Of course, you know, in a pluralistic society, you're going to have different opinions about what freedom is. And in this conference, we're going to have a lot of different opinions about what freedom is and can be. Well, sometimes that idea of, you know, what America can be and what freedom can be, we can have disagreements about what that kind of thing is, just as there can be disagreements about what good jazz is as well. And so I've got one last clip here from a movie. If you've ever seen the movie, The Commitments from 1991, a group of musicians from Dublin want to be a soul group, but they've got different ideas and dramatic conflict ensues.
Some good old love, got some soul. When it comes to taking a load, you got to come back tomorrow. Boys will
And the manager in the audience is like, what are you doing? No, jazz is not, you don't do jazz here. Soul has corners. Jazz spirals. Jazz is for people that want to do their own thing. Jazz is for the individual. Well, jazz done poorly is all about the individual. Does that mean that America done poorly is only about the individual too? That's the kind of question that I think that I'm trying to set up here. What have we heard? What have we looked at? Improvisation. And we can like keep the parallel ideas here, the musical idea and the American governance idea. Okay, yeah, you're going to make up your notes when you play, but you got to follow the 1-4-5. Well, you can follow your dreams and speak your mind, but you got to obey the laws. We're a nation of laws. That call and response, that back and forth is not just one person. It's that one person and a group. It's a partnership. Okay. And you can say that jazz is thesis, antithesis, synthesis. Okay. It puts together different things. Jazz does. It puts together the rhythms of Africa and the melodies and harmonies of Europe. It is both a thinking music and a dancing music. It makes you want to move, but it makes you, you know, sometimes you need to really concentrate. It, when a person is improvising, they are doing two jobs at the same time. These two jobs used to be separate. The composer writes down the music and the performer then performs that music. Two different jobs. When you're improvising, you're both the composer and the performer in the same moment. And you fuse the importance, you balance, you synthesize the needs of the group with the needs of the individual in jazz. They call jazz America's only indigenous art form. It's made by only people that were here. And it only makes sense that it reflects who we are. It can't not. Music is a mirror of reality. How we see ourselves and how we see the society around us. And if we're going to come up with an original kind of thing, it's going to reflect how we feel about ourselves and one another. My influence and your influence come together to make, it's complex, it's messy. It is like this. Don't we think that sometimes American life is like this? Yes, yes, we do. And sometimes we think American life is like this. Yes, we do. Well, to be in America is to improvise. You get to do what you want, and everybody gets to do what they want within the rules as a group. And is it only Americans that have this idea? Well, I think there's another person that nailed this idea. This South African said it best. For to be free is not merely to cast off one's chains, but to live in a way that respects and enhances the freedom of others. It's something to consider that American freedom is a balance, and jazz freedom is a balance. And you have these two ideas of this music and freedom. And I'll sum up with these two questions. And, you know, you can decide for yourself what the your answers are, because we've disabled the, we could talk about it in the chat. But I already know the answers to these questions that I'm going to ask you. Two general questions. General question number one. Do you love music? Yes. We all know that music is one of the most powerful forces out there. General question number two, do you love freedom? Of course. Of course we love freedom. So why not be a fan of the kind of music that has the most freedom in it? It is who we are. It's who we are as Americans. It's the musical expression of who we are as Americans and the freedom that we enjoy. And that, with that, I'll conclude my presentation. And we might look at, do we have questions in the chat? I'm going to stop sharing. We got a Q&A here. Brent asks, what is there a correlation between what Coltrane introduced and what was going on in America at the time? Excellent question. Excellent question. Well, I'd start off by saying it can't, if a composer were to try to come up with a music that was totally disconnected to society, that would be impossible. So of course, yeah, probably. I don't know any of the specifics of he saw the world as such, and so he's gonna make his music be a comment on something. Coltrane did go into free jazz after that Giant Steps complexity. Where can I go next? And he did the Ornette Coleman thing into free jazz and got a lot of criticism for it, because how do you go from highly regulation to no regulation? This is kind of, people couldn't hold on to him there. So the correlation of what was happening in America at the time, we're looking at the 1950s, 1960s, and I would be really interested to do some research about maybe his musical output was in relation to the civil rights struggle of the time, that maybe he was trying to have his voice and such. So, yeah. I hope that answers your question, Brent, or at least it's going to inspire me to do a little more research on that subject. Great question.
I have a question.
Please.
And I know that jazz is like the first cultural export of the United States historically, but it's in some ways the blues not also a unique American creation, because isn't jazz built from the blues? Does blues sure. come from somewhere else?
Sure. No. The difference there would be in what we're going to call an art form or not, and that the blues is more of a colloquial sort of untrained kind of a thing. Whereas if we're going to call the art form and give it that label, then there is going to need to be some sort of sophisticated evolution of it into like the higher art form of what we are going to call jazz music.
I see.
Both indigenous and, though. Yeah, right.
And what about rock and roll and bluegrass and mm-hmm. country? Are they derivative? Do they come from jazz and the blues and to be their own form, or?
Right. The metaphor that I use is there's a trunk of the tree, and as you go through time, big branch, smaller branches, and we live out on the leaves of hundreds of thousands of different styles. Further back you go, okay? The trunk of that tree is the blues, and out of the blues comes then your rock and roll and your country and your bluegrass and your jazz, right? Just kind of different takes on the same thing. Different takes on the blues.
Okay, and Duane has a question.
Yep, please.
It says, not a question, but that there is not just one style of jazz, which makes it good that listeners can hear different styles and perhaps one or more of the other than another style, but something for all.
He goes on to say the blues are infused into all styles of music. Yeah. Now that back, if I could circle that back to Brent's question, was the blues have a relationship to what was going on back then? The 1920s and 1930s blues was happening in Jim Crow America by African Americans. And they had a lot to feel the blues about. And there is a cry in the blues notes that if you want to express your sorrow, you can play a blues song. And maybe the creation of the blues came out through hardship that those musicians were facing.
Would your theory or your thesis here of freedom of jazz, and mm-hmm. an expression of American freedom, is that yeah. connecting it back to the blues? Because the blues is built off spirituals, mm-hmm. Slaves, of enslaved Americans, and that yearning for freedom. Do you think that's that connect somehow or another artistically connects that sense or desire of freedom connects to the art form of jazz where there's an expression of freedom? I'm not sure there's an answer to that. I just kind of thought that.
I think those things happen simultaneously, and maybe the music is an expression of the desire. Right, right. I don't think you can ever separate those kinds of things, that if you're gonna make a musical expression, it can't not be, if done right, it can't not be a comment on where your place is and how you see yourself. So yeah, always entwined.
Okay, are there any other questions? If not, thank you, Professor Laney, for an excellent and revealing look at jazz music, a music I've never really appreciated until I was sitting there listening to it. And I was really, really going to it. I was really, really liked it. So thanks an awful lot. And thank you to all of the attendees as well. I really appreciate it. And I